Bronte, look, we know that there was a bit of drama towards the end of last year and in the lead up. Given the recent rumours, do you think this was a risk mitigation strategy by the Queen?
Look, it's certainly interesting timing. It's been a weird few months for the royals, who are traditionally extremely popular. People love Mary and Frederick and they view theirs as this fairy tale marriage. So when rumours surfaced a few months ago that Frederick was potentially allegedly having an affair, something which has been denied by the woman that was named at the centre of it, it really kind of threw a spanner in the works for the family. So the fact that this has come, you know, after the Queen has been on the throne for more than half a century, and this has come just a few months later, it does send a message of family unity, seeing Prince Frederick and Princess Mary step up to the plate now and have that bestowed upon them by the outgoing Queen. So that will certainly help their image. It will also add further scrutiny. We're always watching them now when they're out. People have been looking for any signs of strain or tension. That certainly won't ease now that they're going to be even more in the spotlight. But, yeah, it's certainly been pointed out that it's interesting timing.
Now, Angela, this isn't the only drama. We understand there's another split in the family is between Frederick and his brother. Look, we don't know 100% what's going on there, but do we know where this is all stemmed from?
Look, this, of course, stemmed from when the Queen stripped Prince Joachim's children of their titles. The four of them in late 2022 had, they were princes and princesses, they were made count and countesses. At the time, of course, they didn't know that this was about to happen. They, even though it was apparently discussed, she came in quickly with this decision and it caused a split in the family. As we know, Mary even stood up for the Queen at that time, saying that these decisions do hurt. But of course, there are, the family have spent time together subsequent to that split, but they have, the younger brother and his family have moved to Washington now, so they're not that close. We think that the younger brother is going to come to the proclamation, but as for his wife and the four children, there's no suggestion that they are going to be there. What's worrying about this, of course, is that Frederick and Mary only have, there's only one brother, so they need that support. Prince Christian, their son, is only 18. It's not like he can sort of step into the multiple roles. And as we've seen with the British royal family, if you slim it down too much, everybody gets quite busy and overworked.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. That's absolutely true. They do. Now, Bronte, like Angela said, you know, we don't think necessarily that the prince's children are planning to attend. Given the nature of the events that happened a year or so ago, do you think that that has something to do with it?
Look, by all current reports, as we've said, it looks like they won't be there, which is, of course, drawing some parallels to some other royals that we know with recent coronations. but the statement even sort of echoes to what Meghan and Harry had put out last year when Meghan and the kids didn't attend that coronation, and that is that the kids have school, which is true. But also, it's, of course, a really significant family occasion and a historic occasion. So you do wonder whether that is playing a role. I think it's very likely that possibly, you know, while things have been smoothed over to a point and they all spent Christmas together in Denmark, there is probably still some hurt there as they move on past this. It was such a massive event when the Queen made that announcement, you know, with the younger brother even speaking out publicly to the local media. I think that will take a while to heal. There's certainly some wounds there, and that may be playing a role in why he's chosen to attend and the rest of the family will stay back home.
Yeah, and I think that's probably right. I guess the point that I would make there is you'd think that they'd at least go to support their grandmother who's abdicating such a senior position that she's held for such a long time. For me, that's actually kind of the weirder part than the proclamation and the ascension of Frederick and Mary to the positions of King and Queen. But, Angela, you know, it's not hard to draw parallels between Frederick and Joachim with William and Harry. Are there any particular similarities potentially in the deterioration of that relationship?
Oh, lots of similarities, of course. This sort of hurt at being the spare. And, you know, it's a year on since Prince Harry's book Spare was published. Children fighting for their titles, a family decamped to America are the only thing that the younger prince hasn't done in Denmark's case is that he hasn't written a book yet. But, yeah, there's obviously quite a lot of hurt and distress there, as Bronte said. But, yeah, plenty of parallels. And it'll be an interesting one to watch to see what sort of support is there for Harry... is there for Frederick and Mary. Look, see, even I'm confused with them. To see what support is there going forward for his brother. The other thing, of course, is that Frederick doesn't actually want to be king. He's never been keen on that role. He's very reticent. He doesn't like public speaking. Mary's much more talented in that regard. So at least he's got her by his side.
Thank God, because I think he's going to need her just quietly. Mm. Now, Bronte, on the Donaldson side of the ledger, who is and isn't attending this weekend?
So we have Mary's sister will be there. She's really close with her older sister, Jane, who lives in Tasmania. She was a bridesmaid at the royal wedding in 2004, along with her other sisters and best friend. So she'll be there to support her sister, which is fantastic. Sadly, Mary's father won't be able to make the journey. He's in his 80s now and he's struggled with some health issues in recent years, which has seen him have to miss other important events in Denmark. But he actually lived in Copenhagen for years just to be close by with Mary and the kids. So I'm certain he'll be extremely disappointed to be missing out, and that will be felt by Mary as well.
I think it will, but it is totally understandable. Now, Angela, Australians love a celebration, as you well know, and the Sydney pub where Frederick and Mary met up during the Sydney Olympics is planning to mark the occasion themselves. What are they up to?
That's right. They're not actually open on Sunday, which is, of course, the day of the proclamation, but in the weeks that follow, in the next month, it's going to be a Scandinavian-themed menu. So if you want some herrings or roll mops, that pickled fish, you can head on down there. There's also going to be something about Mary cocktail, which I understand contains vanilla and lychee and vodka. So lots of celebration. Very proud, obviously, that pub that was the meeting place for this wonderful royal story. So, yes, I think they'll have the flags and the bunting out. And I wonder if Mary and Fred will one day pop back there and have a celebratory drink of their own.
Yeah, what a way to become a landmark in this country. Now, Bronte, a recent popularity poll on the Danish Royal shows that Mary remains very popular. The family more broadly aren't without popularity challenges. Can you run us through this?
So the family's actually been extremely popular for a long time. The outgoing queen, has been extremely popular. She's seen as extremely down to earth, and people just love her. It's a very similar sort of situation to what we saw with the late Queen Elizabeth II. And Mary and Frederick themselves are really popular. They seem to be really connected with issues that the modern issues that people are caring about now. And Mary, for example, is engaged with LGBT rights, women's reproductive rights, and things like that. So they actually have, they poll up in the 80s. But interestingly, Mary is now more popular than Frederick. And this is where the challenge has been. A lot of royal experts in Denmark have pointed out that that has declined for him a little because of these rumours that have dogged him recently. So that's going to be a challenge moving forward as he sort of shrugs that off and steps into this new role and proves that he is a family man and dedicated to the job and dedicated to his wife, I suppose. So that's been something that they've had to take into consideration, but again, speaks to just how important Mary is in the monarchy there and why this is such an incredible moment for her, but it's an incredible moment for the royal family there because they need her.
Absolutely, they do. And Angela, look, I've only got about a minute left before we have to move on. We talk about popularity polls all the time, and whether it's the Danish royals or the British royals. And how in tune do you think that everyday people are with the royal intrigues? And to what extent do you think they give credence to these sorts of rumours?
Look, I think that people are hugely interested. I mean, it's the greatest living soap opera, isn't it? And we've seen that with the British royal family for decades. And as Bronte talked about earlier, this alleged affair with Frederick. I think what they really look at, though, is ongoing character and purpose. We've seen that with the Princess of Wales and her legacy project with children. And I think we're going to see it with Mary. If you think about it, Mary lost her mother at the age of 26. The outgoing Queen lost her mother, her father, and took on the role of Queen when she was 31. These are both very, very strong women, very purposeful, very dignified. I think there's a lot in common between the outgoing Queen and the one to follow her. And I think people really go by character, despite them being endlessly fascinated by gossip.
Absolutely. Angela Mollard, Bronte Coy, thank you so much.